morning, church. Let's stand this morning as we sing about the blood of Jesus. Hebrews 9:22 says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Says you were not redeemed with the perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood as of a lamb, undefiled and spotless, the blood of Christ.
The blood that Jesus shed. Gives me strength from
Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Thank you.
This time we let's go to the Lord in prayer. We're going to take our offering in just a moment. Mike's going to come and give some updates on Brother Bill, then also talk about some things moving forward. This is our time of our offering. Just remember that you can give here at the end, online. You can mail your check. You can come by the office during the week. Thank you again for your continued giving. Appreciate all that you've done on that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then Mike give us some updates. Father, we thank you for the cross. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed for our forgiveness of sins. God, something that we couldn't do by ourselves. God, it wasn't the bulls and the goats and the lambs of the Old Testament, but it was the blood of Jesus, our Savior. And God, you did that even though while we were still sinners, you loved us enough to send your Son to die for us. And we thank you for that. God, be with Brother Jerry as he comes to speak to us in a moment. Just pray you'll use him and let us hear the word of God as he preaches. Thank you for all of your blessings. Continue to be with Brother Bill and heal his body and be with Nancy. Just pray you'll uplift their family and just take care of all their needs. Thank you for our church. Just pray you'll continue to help us to proclaim the gospel each and every week. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. That song starts out, "How Deep His Love." Wow. Great. Before I update you on Brother Bill, I wanted to make an announcement that we're going to be, it's been on our prayer chain, but we're going to get it up on our Facebook page, and we're going to get it up on everything we can, and you'll also receive a postcard in the mail about some changes that we're going to make for the month of October. In October, we're going to start our Sunday school classes at 8:45, and that'll be a fellowship time for the first 15 minutes. And then we'll have our Sunday school from 9 to 9:45, and then we'll have church from 10 to 11. We're going to do this in order to build momentum for the church. And this is probably the best crowd I've seen in the early service, and this service, it has been great to see y'all coming back. You know, I've been at restaurants. I've been at sporting events with my grandkids. Joy and I are the only ones that wear masks, but that's okay. And then somebody sits by us, we move, you know. And I'm sure we make some folks upset. But, you know, if the sporting events are open, if schools are open, our church is open, and we want you back. And so I'm begging, you know, please come back. This is the place that you should start going back to events. This is the place that we need to be. It's just so great to see all of y'all here this morning. So you will be updated. David Edmonds will be here next week. Is it David? Daniel. I knew it was wrong when I said it. Daniel Edmonds will be here next week in both services, and so we will have both services next week. We also will have our nursery up and running for both services, for not only Bible study but for church. And so that will give a lot of people an opportunity to come back that haven't had an opportunity to come back. A couple of prayer requests before I update you on Bill. I want to mention, I was told this morning that Maxine Waters is in the hospital with having surgery. Maxine Hunt, excuse me. Please be in prayer for her. And then Keith Dempsey, and you may not recognize the name, but he is our maintenance guy. He does all the painting and all the stuff that's done around the church. Please be in prayer for him. He had a biopsy, and he's waiting on the results of that biopsy. And then Karen Stewart has started her stem cell transplant. Please be in prayer for her. Obviously for Bill and Nancy. Those are the ones that I have. Nancy sent this morning, and I'll update you. She says, "Good morning." She says, "I know the church will want an update. I go to see Bill every other day. He looks good, and he is still stable. To say there is no change is not, in my opinion, the correct statement. It may appear there is no change, but I believe every day Jesus, by his grace, is healing Bill's body. It takes time, so when you don't hear any updates, just keep praying. The doctor said it would take 2 weeks or more. The nurses are hanging the cards you send on the wall, so when he comes out of sedation, he will see them. I am teaching school every other day. My energy is coming back. Thank you. Thank you for your prayers and love toward Bill and me." And then she asked me to read Jeremiah 32:17, which says, "Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arms. There is nothing too hard for you." So I just ask you to be in prayer for them. That's the latest update, but we are going to start updating more on Facebook and that kind of thing for all kinds of things that'll be going on. Please be in prayer for our church as we make this transition. I cannot emphasize enough that it is temporary. We're going to do this for the month of October, so I know it will be a little inconvenient for you folks to get here a little bit early, but it'll also be a little inconvenient for the folks that come to the early service. So just be in prayer about that. If you have any questions, emails, texts, send them to me, not to Nancy, okay? If you have anything that you need done at your house, if you're not been able to come to church, we have deacons that will take care of that. And so I just ask you to continue to pray for our church as we go forward. Thank you. All right, everybody, I want to show you what we're going to be doing now from now on to make sure the sanctuary is sanitized. We've got a new sanitizing gun here, and Ronnie's got another one he's going to bring up here and show you. The bigger one we're going to be using in the gym and the bathrooms and that, but in right now, in between services or before all the services start, we've got this new atomizer that we're going to be using. I'm going to demonstrate it for you so that you feel comfortable when you come in and it goes down here and you spray. Spray all this off, and then that'll dry again, and it's got a UV light in it so it sticks, but within a very short period of time, it's dry. So I just wanted to show everybody here that we're going to be making some changes in how we do things to make sure that you're comfortable when you come back to service. Thank you.
This is a much bigger one. We use it before services, and you have to go fast with it. Like that. It puts out a lot more disinfectant. It would have to be dried in between services, but we'll be planning on doing it on Thursdays with the cleaning ladies, and then it'll dry by. We won't have to dry it then. But in between services, I think this littler one will spray enough, but yet it'll be dry before the second service. Thank you very much.
Well, these young folks here, these children, did you see Star Wars? That blue light on that spray thing? There's no sound effects. As I told the early service, I'm really not glad to be up here today because I would rather Brother Bill be right here. So we're praying for his soon return. And God's good, and God will raise him up and get him back among us. If you have your Bibles, Hebrews chapter 6, verses 17 through 20. This is the main text, but I'll be using some other places to bring some things I hope will be helpful. I've given this message a title, which I don't do a whole lot of, but the text just seemed to bring it out. But the title is Our Anchor in These Grievous Times. Our Anchor in These Grievous Times. I'm going to go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And in 2 Timothy chapter 3, the first verse, it says, "But know this, that the last days, in the last days, perilous times shall come." That word perilous can be translated, and sometimes is, as grievous. Grievous times. And I like one definition that I read about it because it seems so down to earth. Times that are hard to deal with. Times that are hard to deal with. And certainly The days in which we live give us much anxiety and concern, and our heart breaks as we see all the things that are going on around us, and it seems that all restraints have been removed from some people and they're free to do pretty well whatever they want to, usually bad. But Paul goes on in this text in Timothy and says, and you can see the description of the times we're in these verses. It said, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And he says, and from such people turn away. So in this list of things that are truly bad, we're seeing pretty much all of this being fleshed out today. If you watch the news, you see those kinds of things, and it's so heartbreaking. One of the things in that is the word traitors in verse 4. And that's one of the things that's particularly heartbreaking for me, to see people who live in America betraying America on the media. They're protesting, they're declaring their hatred for what America is. And I hope that that doesn't spill over into the upcoming election, because it could really be detrimental to our nation. Verse 5, it says, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. Another thing that's so concerning to me is that some of this stuff is finding its way into the church. I don't mean this church. I mean the church in general. I was studying for a message the first part of last week that I thought I was going to bring today, but I decided that maybe I shouldn't, that this was more needful, God directing, I pray. But I delved into a lot of areas that I didn't know about, and I learned a lot, and I'm telling you, there's some things really, really, you need to be praying for our Southern Baptist Convention. You really do. There's some bad, bad things coming down the pike, and when it gets started, it has a tendency to snowball. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, Peter gives some things, too, about the last days. In verse 9 of chapter 2, he says, for the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations. That's good. The word temptations there is a word that means trials, difficulties. These are trying times as well as being grievous and difficult times. And he says, not only to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. Folks don't generally like to hear about God's judgment. They have a God that fits their need, you know, the all-loving God and the God who gives you a pass on things. They just don't like to think of a God who is severe and who does bring judgment. But indeed, he does. In verse 10, and especially those who walk according to the flesh, in the lust of uncleanness and despise authority. There's another thing we can see. What's happening concerning our law enforcement people, and we have some in our church, and we're so appreciative of them. We have a grandson that is a policeman, and we have concern for him every day. But the terrible disrespect for authority. If we don't have authority, we're in great peril, you know, because people have to know there's a restraint and there are consequences for our actions, but when you remove the consequences, you remove the restraint. And human nature being what it is, it causes them to pull out all the stops on their deeds. Then he says they are presumptuous. The word presumptuous is a word that means daring, shameless, and irreverent. And we see all of that taking place in our nation in these days. That's why they're grievous times. When we come to our text in Hebrews, we need to understand that the writer of Hebrews is dealing in these verses, as well as others, with some difficult times that not only the Hebrew Christians, but the Gentile Christians are going through. And he's writing to them to encourage them not to give up, not to fall prey to false teachings and those kinds of things. And of course, Peter and Jude talk about those. But they were under pressure, very real pressure. And some were beginning to really crumble in their resolve and their commitment to Christ. And some of it was on the theological area. They were wanting to depart from the faith to go where it's safer. You know, used to in America, I didn't say this in the early service, but Christianity was safe in America. Remember that? People had respect for the church and the things of God. But that's not true anymore. To be a Christian in America is beginning to be not exactly dangerous, but uncomfortable. You know, much of America, and we have in the Southeast, we don't have quite as much negativity toward the church and Christians. That is, overtly, there are people who hold things inside. But the geography above us and to the west of us, they're more overt and open with their hatred for the church, for hatred for Christians. And of course, what happens over there, usually like a tidal wave, comes flowing across the other states. And of course, there's some up on the East Coast as well. And so we need a word of encouragement. And that's what I wanted to do today. I have to look at the negative things to show us how good the good stuff is. And so, the writer, and I'm going to begin reading in verse 17 and go down through 20. Now, he's already talked about God's covenant and promises that God made to Abraham. And he told Abraham he'd make him the father of many nations, and he'd have many heirs, and I think he's talking about spiritual heirs as well. And not only do we put this back there, but it has meaning for us today, because Paul brought this into the New Testament in Galatians and talked about that Abraham was justified by his faith, to show how we as believers are justified before God by our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, in verse 17, he says, "Thus God, determining to show more abundantly to the heirs of promise. That would be us as well as those who were more near to that event. The heirs of promise, believers, to determine to show them the promise and the immutability of his counsel. That means that God is not going to change his mind. There's a lot of folk in America today and in the church who need to understand God does not change his mind. I thought the other day the reason he put the Ten Commandments in stone was to emphasize that. It wasn't in there with ink or pencil. It was in stone. And even when those commandments were broken, he redid it. And I think the text says and added many more things. So what God meant last century, he means now. What he meant 2,000 years ago, he means now. And even before that, all the way back to Genesis. So his promises are immutable, and they were confirmed by an oath. And he goes on to say in verse 18, that by two immutable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we might have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope set before us. The two immutable things, many commentators suggest, is God's character and God's oath. God backs up his word. He backs up his promises with his character. That would be enough, but also by his oath. And so it's fixed and it's firm. It's immutable, but it's also immovable. Nothing's going to change God's mind on that. And then he talks about hope in these verses. Hope. That's what we need today, isn't it? We need hope, and we have hope. We've had hope all along. Sometimes we let the things that are going on around us put us down. I mean, I get a little depressed at times when I think about what's going on. I think, Lord, I just feel like kind of giving up, not giving in, but just kind of giving up on it. It looks like it's... But then he reminds me that he's on duty. He's manning the watch, and he's got it all in control. It might not seem like that to us, but indeed he does. And so he talks about the hope that is set before us. We flee to it for refuge. And then he said this hope we have as an anchor for the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enters into the presence behind the veil. When Jesus was crucified and he was raised, you know that after some days he took his disciples and went up to a mountain, and there something wonderful happened. They thought it was bad, but in fact, it turned out that it was good. And Luke records these things. And Luke is really the only one, and I'm talking about his ascension. Luke is the only one that gives us some detail about what happened at the ascension of Christ. In Luke 24, we see, and of course, Luke wrote Luke and Acts, but in Luke 24, in verse 50, Luke writes this, and he, Jesus, led them out as far as Bethany and lifted up his hands and blessed them. Now, in lifting up his hands, this was no small thing. It wasn't that he just looked out and lifted his hands. What Jesus was doing there was he was giving them the high priestly blessing. On the Day of Atonement, when the high priest would go in behind the veil and he would offer the blood on the mercy seat, the lid of the ark, making atonement for the sins of the people. Many sacrifices had been made before, but this one act of atonement was in somewhat, this takes care of it all, at least for a year. He had to do it over and over. But when he would go in there and do that, when he would come out, he would lift his hands and give the priestly blessing on all of those gathered. And so what he was doing was giving the priestly blessing, the great high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ. And it said in verse 51, "Now it came to pass while he blessed them that he was parted from them and carried up into heaven." Now, if we go to the book of Acts, the first chapter, Luke picks up here and kind of gives a little bit more. You know, in movies they have, you know, they put a one beside one, a part two beside. Well, this Acts is Luke part two because he wrote them both. But he puts in the first chapter in verse 9, he said, "Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight." Now that cloud that received him, I do not think it is water vapor or condensation. I think it is that special Shekinah glory cloud that we see back in the Old Testament, back in Exodus, where God would appear and he would appear in a cloud. And that was certainly partly to obscure his presence that would be so strong that it would literally kill people. And even Jesus, when he went up on the Mount of Transfiguration, a cloud engulfed them while they were there, and it talks about his glory radiating out from his person. And I think what was happening there was, and some commentator said that cloud was like God wrapping his arms around his son and lifting him up to heaven to bring him home. But I think part of that was that when Jesus went back to heaven, he didn't go back as they saw him in his resurrected body. He went back in the resurrected body. But when he went back to glory, he received back the full glory that was his before he ever left heaven to come down and die for us on the cross. It was a glorious thing when Jesus entered back in to his heavenly home from which he had come. And when he was raised, we have some scripture that kind of tells us what went on. We don't want to speculate too much. But in Ephesians 1:20, the Apostle Paul writes that God raised him and seated him in heavenly places. Another place will say that Jesus sat down at the right hand of the Father. So when he went back to glory, he took back, didn't forcibly take it back, but he regained the seat that he had left. He didn't lose any of his deity when he came to earth, but he sat down in the position of power and authority. He said, "All authority has been given unto me, both in heaven and in earth." So he is in the place of authority. And remember, we're talking about these grievous times and what people are doing. But he is our Savior, our Lord, and our King. And they just don't know what they're doing in regard to him. But one day, they're going to find out. But another thing he did, and the writer of Hebrews talks about the priesthood of Christ a whole lot. And he talks about the heavenly Holy of Holies. And so Jesus not only went in and occupied the throne, but he goes into the heavenly holy of holies, and there he becomes the mercy seat. Propitiation is that word. The mercy seat. In essence, he is the ark, and he goes back in there in his glory. And so those are two things that happen. Now, when the writer of Hebrews talks about his going in, he talks about the forerunner. Dr. Harry Ironside, who used to be pastor at Moody Memorial Church in Chicago, he died a long, long time ago. And Dr. Herschel Hobbs relates this, and I have his commentary on Hebrews, and so I read the fuller account. But back in those days when ships would come in to go into the harbor, many times there's a sandbar that builds up, and the ship couldn't get in. The tide would be low. And so what they would do, they would put a sailor in a boat, and that boat was called the forerunner. And they would give him the anchor. Of course, it was connected to the hawser that was tied to the ship. And he would row that forerunner over the sandbar, over into the harbor. And there he would take the anchor out and drop it in. And it would go down and down until it was fastened on a rock or something solid down there. And then the ship would lay out in the harbor and wait for the tide to come up. Should a storm come up while the ship was waiting, the anchor would hold and the ship would not be lost. And then when the tide came up, then they could get the ship into the harbor safely. And so the writer of Hebrews says, this is what Jesus is to us. Not only is he our forerunner, but he's also our anchor, our anchor. Two hymns in Christian hymnology is, one is In Times Like These. How many have heard that? That's an old hymn. And then On Christ the Solid Rock, both of those songs have to do with anchors. In times like these, it says we need a Savior, and then it says we need an anchor. And there's three verses, and then the last of those three verses said, be very sure your anchor holds within the solid rock. Now, the way to be sure is to trust Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, having repented of our sins. It's not just ascending to Jesus and agreeing that you believe what the Bible says about him. It's really committing in faith to him. And people who don't really commit to Christ find difficult times more difficult, harder to bear. But if we are resting secure in our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, if we're anchored into him, then we can ride out the storms in this life. And it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Jesus never said it was easy. As a matter of fact, he said, you will have tribulation. You will have that. This world doesn't like real Christians. Now, they can get along with folks that don't believe this book. There's a lot of them that don't. They just take on the name. And one of the things that Paul said in his verses there in 2 Timothy was that they would have a form of godliness, but they would deny the power thereof. And so there's people today in churches who are having a form of godliness. They kind of go through the motions, but it doesn't do anything really in here. Because at the first sign of trouble, some of them bail out and go their way. But he's the forerunner. He's gone into the heavenly holy of holies. He's sitting enthroned by the right hand of the Father. And he's our high priest. He's making intercession for us every day. And so we're really safe in the storm. We're safe in the storm. If you'll just look ahead out there, you'll see that hawser or that chain going into that heavenly harbor. We're not there yet, but one day we're going to get to go on in. And I'm looking forward to that day. I was in the Navy, of course, and I remember one time, it was in July of 1961, we pulled into Eastport, Maine. Eastport, Maine is a different place from what we have here. There's a lot of islands that dot around the areas. One of the things is the tide up there rises and falls 21 feet. So when the tide's going out, there's a rush of water going out. There's a current, And so our ship couldn't go into the tie up next to the pier. We had to anchor out. And when we would go on Liberty, we'd have to get on the Liberty launch and go over to the beach and get out there and go on Liberty and come back. Well, when we left the ship, it would be facing this way. When we got back, it would be facing that way. It was riding the anchor, but the ship wasn't harmed. It was fixed by that anchor to the bottom of the bay. And so, spiritually speaking, that's how we are. We're anchored to in the Holy of Holies. We're secure, anchored to the throne and anchored to the ark in the Holy of Holies. And that's pretty secure, wouldn't you say? We don't have to worry about that. And then in the 18th verse of chapter 6, he talks about that hope. In Colossians 2:20 or 3:20, I think it is, Paul calls the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ our blessed hope. Our blessed hope. And so no matter how bad it gets, we need to keep these things in mind. And one of the ways to do that is get in the Word of God. And I don't know what you do, but sometimes when these things get to pressing in on me, I go back and see if God changed his mind. And I found out he didn't. And that makes me feel great. I know he's not going to change his mind, but I just like to see it in black and white. And there's a comfort there. It looks permanent that nothing can shake it loose. So in Peter's 2 Peter chapter 2 that I cited, I think, a while ago, I may not have. But when he talks about God knowing how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment, and he says concerning them, especially those who walk according to the flesh and the lust of uncleanness and despise authority. That's where we are now, despise authority. No president in history has ever had to undergo the disrespect of his authority the way our president has now. No matter what you might think of him, he has been battling in the office of presidency the whole time he's been in. Because of a lack of respect for authority, God ordained authority, and God expects us to respect authority. Now, there's things we can do about authority we don't like. We do have the privilege to vote. In the New Testament time, I don't think they voted on their officials. They just had what they had. But we can, with using biblical things, compare candidates and know how we should vote. But anyway, he lets us know that we have a hope and that God's going to deliver us out. And those people who are the oppressors, God is going to judge. Now, I don't say that with glee. I don't want to see those people have to go through that. But they will if they don't repent and trust in Jesus. And then I want to share a little something right here at the end that I thought on this a long, long time. I've always wanted to say it, so I've got a platform. But anyway, in the book of Revelation, when you go through the book and things begin to wrap up, in the 20th chapter, we see some things coming together, and I think it's almost just a brief look at everything, and of course there's more to come after that. But it's after the tribulation, and even after the millennium. For some strange reason, we think God lets Satan out again. Isn't that odd? He lets him out again. He's been chained up in the shaft of the abyss for that 1,000 years, and then he's able to amass himself an army and so on. But Jesus finishes that off really easily. But in verse 11, it says, "Then I saw a great white throne." Now that's the judgment of all judgments. Lost people will be there. "And him who sat on it," and this expression here, "from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away." And when I read that, knowing that John wrote this, you go back to the Gospel of John, and on that night when Jesus was in the garden and was betrayed by Judas Iscariot, his people stepped forward and asked, "Where is Jesus?" And Jesus physically steps forward and he says, "I am." And they fell back. They couldn't stand before the face of the Lord Jesus Christ. So when Revelation ends up, everything in the universe, and I'm not one of those who believes in a renovation at the end. I believe in a complete recreation. That is, the heavens and the earth and all of that fled from the face of Jesus. In 2 Peter chapter 3, 7, in that section, it talks about things burning up and everything. And I read what I get from that is, ain't nothing left. And then God recreates everything. And it's without sin, because every molecule in our world and in the universe has now been tainted by sin. And there's not going to be any sin in the new heavens and the new earth. And so Christ has the last word. And so as Psalm 2 says, the heathens can rage and they can imagine a vain thing. He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. It's not funny to him, but it's that laugh that is like a superior to an inferior. How pathetic. How pathetic. Don't fear those people. They're pathetic. The most they can do is kill us. But Jesus is going to raise us. And we're going to live with him forever and ever. I didn't say anything about it in the first service, but there was a song a few years ago called "Lift Up Your Head, Redemption Draweth Nigh." So these things we're seeing are things that may be getting ready to usher in the coming of our Lord and the rapture. I can't say when. I wouldn't try to. It may not be now, it could be another 1,000 years. I don't know. But all I know is we've never been through what we're going through. People have never thought like they're thinking now. They've given themselves completely over to Satan and his vices. So if you're here and you've never put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, then please hear me. It's not just a matter of saying a prayer and asking Jesus into your heart. There are people that think that prayer is awful. I don't. I think people can be saved praying that prayer. But the reality of repenting and trusting in Jesus alone for salvation is what gets us saved. Now, we can formulate a prayer and pray that prayer, but the idea is, are we really repenting and are we really trusting? That's the anchor. And so we can anchor ourselves into Christ and all that He is by that faith and that repentance and that commitment. And no matter what else comes, we know that when we draw our last, we'll be with Him forever in that unshakable place. We call it heaven. And would you be ready if that should happen, if He should come? I hope you are, and I pray that you will be. Let's pray as Ray comes. Father, help us in these days to be strong in our faith, to continue to bear our witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, not to be terribly, terribly afraid of what we're seeing going on around us. We know, Father, that Jesus is the victor. And since He's the victor, our being in Him makes us the victor. And we would pray, Father, with one who said, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." Amen.
Let's stand. Thank you for being with us today, and we hope that you'll join us again soon. I want to recommend to you our website, unionhillbaptist.org, and if you check that out, we have weekly videos, resources for children and youth and adults. It's a great way to get to know us, and we hope to see you again soon. Thank you.